prapanna parijataya totra vetraikapanaye jnana mudraya krishnaya gita amruta duhe namaha om. Dear friends, welcome to the study of Gita. We are seeing shloka number 49 of we just read shloka number 48 yesterday, and we have to see shloka number 49 now. Shloka number 49 of the 11th chapter, that is Vishwarupa Darshana Yoga. So yesterday we saw how Krishna was telling Arjuna, so this is one form which is not possible to be seen by studying Veda, by doing yajnas, by doing danam, by doing various other rituals, by performing so many vratams and tirthayatras and what not. By going to all these tirthayatras and all that, okay, you have some peace of mind, you have some nice feeling, and you also have some punyam, you will get a lot of punyam. And with that punyam, what are you attaining? By that punyam, you are again, you are continuing in the cycle of life, you are continuing in this cycle. And you are not getting that complete vision, you are not getting that Vishwarupa, you are not having the understanding of that cosmic form, you are only seeing some limited forms. By going to Venkateswara, you see one limited form, by going to some other place, you see another limited form. So you see like that. So that is what Krishna said. And by evam rupam shakya aham ruloke drashtum, it is impossible for anybody to see this form, and nobody else has seen this form apart from you. Now we come to the next shloka, that is 49th shloka, and where he is again assuring, because Krishna is finding Arjuna is so much terrified. So he is now trying to console him, he is now trying to bring him back, because he is so shocked. Mate vyatha maja vimudha bhavo drushtva rupam ghoramidrum mamedam vyapeta bhih pritamanah punastvam tadeva me rupam idam prapasya. So Krishna is saying, I am now showing my normal form, you also come back to your normal self. Tadeva me rupam idam prapasya, my old form I am showing you please come back to your senses. And he says, Ma te vyatha means, te means to you, vyatha. Vyatha means that distressed state of mind. Vyatha, we use the word in Telugu also. What vyatha jandutunnadu, we say vyatha. Vyatha means somebody who is having that distressed mind, that is vyatha. And what can we say? Yeah, somebody who is terrified, that particular terrified state, so that is what is vyatha. Ma te vyatha means te to you, ma te vyatha maastu, you don't have that, don't have any panic, don't be panicky, don't have that sense of panic in your mind. And ma cha vimudha bhavaha maastu, ma astu, that astu we have to borrow that word here, that is vimudha bhavaha. Vimudha is what? A totally deluded type of mind. So when he has seen such a huge cosmic form, Arjuna, it is not only Arjuna, but it is possible for anybody. Of course, Arjuna was a very great warrior and a man with a great sense of, magnanimity, that great personality. But even such a great person, he was so terrified. So, maja vimudha bhava, don't get deluded, don't have any type of delusions, deluded thinking. Maja vimudha bhava, drushtva rupam, having seen this particular form, ghoram idruk mamedam, idruk plus mamedam, idrung mamedam, the idruk means this type of ghoram, ghora again is terrible. So, Ishvara is having both ghora rupa and aghora rupa. Even in the case of Rudra, we talk about aghorebhyo, atha ghorebhyo. So there is one aghora form. Aghora means gentle, benign form. And ghora rupa, terrific form. So what Krishna showed was ghora rupa. Now he is showing his aghora, he is going to show his aghora rupa. Aghora means gentle, benign, not ghoram. Ghora is something which is terrific. Drushtva rupam ghoram idruk mama idam. Mama plus idam is mama idam. This terrible form, having seen my terrible form, you have become so distressed. Don't have that panic in mind, and don't be deluded. You come back to your normal thinking. And now, vyapeta bhihi, get rid of your fear. Vyapeta, vyapeta bhihi means a person whose fear is driven away, this person is whose fear is sent away. Bhihi, bhihi means fear. Vyapeta bhihi means a person whose fear has gone away. Vyapeta bhihi, preetamanaha means preeti is what? Preeti means some calmness of mind, coolness of mind. Preetamanaha means a person who has come back to his normal cool self. So come back to your normal gentle self, normal your cool self. Preetamanaha, punaha tvam, punaha means again, tvam, tadeva me rupamidam prapashya. That form only which you asked, that initially Arjuna asked for that chaturbhuja form. So Krishna is also going to show that chaturbhuja form and again coming back to the normal two-hand, normal human form. That we see in the next shloka. That next shloka is 50th shloka. 50th shloka now Sanjaya is describing. Because Krishna is now showing that that four hands form, chaturbhuja form, and again coming back to the normal human form. Sanjaya uvacha, this shloka number 50. Ityarjunam vasudevastatoktva svakam rupam darshayamasa bhuyaha. Ashvasayamasa cha bhitamenam bhutva punas saumyavapuram mahatma. So here he says, iti arjunam vasudevaha tatha uktva. We have to break the words like that. Vasudevaha arjunam evam uktva. So vasudeva, we know that vasudeva, we have to know that, we have discussed this word several times, but still I repeat. Vasudeva, we should not take it as son of Vasudeva. Son of Vasudeva is okay. But Vasudeva, we are now using it as Vasudeva Sarvamiti. That is, a person who knows that Vasudeva is that Sarvam. Sarvatayeva Sarvaha. We saw those words earlier. So, Vasudeva is Vasu. Vasudeva, that is Vasati. He dwells in all the beings. And all the entire universe dwells in him. That is what that Vasudeva. Vasanti jaganti asmin. All the worlds, all the jagat, the entire jagat, it is in him. So that means he is the indweller of all things. So in that sense we have to see Vasudeva. So Vasudeva, he told this Arjuna, tatha uktva svakam rupam darshayamasa bhuyaha. Bhuyaha means again. Svakam rupam, swam rupam. Svakam is the same as swam rupam, his own rupa. Vasudevas, what is Vasudevas swarupam? Vasudevas swarupam is that four-headed, four hands, that particular form. That is the form of Vasudeva. So, svakam rupam darshayamasa. Darshayamasa means he showed to Arjuna. And again, ashvasayamasa. Cha bhitam enam. Enam Arjunam. Enam Arjunam means this Arjuna. Bhitam yenam, this Arjuna who stands terrified. Arjuna bhita, bhita is what? Bhitam is terrified. Arjuna is standing terrified. So Krishna is again doing that ashvasanam. Ashvasanam is, nowadays we see when somebody swoons, we sprinkle some water on his face and then we gently tap them. And if some sort of resuscitation is needed, people also do some resuscitation. So like that, Krishna, of course he did not sprinkle water and all that. He was doing some ashvasanam. He was just trying, maybe Krishna patted on his shoulder, we do not know. So ashvasayamasa, he consoled him, he just gave courage to him. Ashvasanam, it is called ashvasanam. Ashvasanam, shvasa, we know, shvasa is what? Shvasa is breath. Ashvasanam means suppose somebody has no breath. Again, you put your mouth into his mouth and you again breathe into the lungs, so that again lungs will come back. That is ashvasanam. Literally speaking, that is ashvasanam. So that means again, strictly speaking, that is a resuscitation. So something like that. Figuratively, it means consoling, giving courage to him. Ashvasayamasacha bhitam enam. Arjuna was so terrified. And bhutva punaha saumya vapur mahatma. Again, he came back to his saumya form. Saumya means the gentle, benign form. Saumya. Saumyam, we know saumyam. We also use it in Telugu. Chala saumyam, what is chala saumyamandi we say. Saumyam is a very gentle person. What is that gentle form? That is a normal gentle form with the two hands. Saumya vapuhu, vapu is body. Saumya vapuhu, that is gentle frame, gentle form. Mahatma refers to Krishna. Krishna again showed his gentle form. He initially showed that Chaturbhuja form and then again consoled him, then again showed his normal form, that is with ordinary Krishna with the two hands, and that is the picture. Then Arjuna is now happy. Arjuna is now, he has come back to his senses. Arjuna also done, he is also a brave man, he is a hero. So it is not as though Arjuna was so terrified and then he was so panicky and all that. Even such a great man was in panic. And after getting consoled by Krishna, he has come back to his normal self. So Arjuna is saying, that is 51st shloka, drushtvedam manusham rupam tava saumyam janardana idanim asmi samvruttah sacheta prakrutim gatah. Now I have come back to my normal form. So that is what he says. Drushtvedam. Drushtvedam is drushtva idam manusham rupam. Idam manusham rupam drushtva. Having seen this human form. Manusham rupam is human form. Manushya. Manusham means belonging to manushya. Manushya is a human. Manusham rupam is human form. Idam manusham rupam. This human form. Drushtva, having seen. Tava saumyam janardana. Hey janardana. O janardana. Tava saumyam rupam. This saumya. This gentle form. Having seen. Idani masmi samvruttaha. Now I have come back. Samvruttaha. Sachetas samvruttaha. Samvruttaha has to be connected to sachetaha. Sachetaha samvruttaha means my mind and senses. My mind and senses are restored. Idanim samvruttaha asmi. That is sachetas samvruttaha. I have again come back to my senses. My mind has come back to its original shape. And prakrutim gataha. Prakruti is what? Prakruti is nature. Prakrutim gatosmi means I have come back to my nature. I have regained my nature. My mind has come back to its senses. I have regained my nature. Having seen your gentle form, that is a Saumya form with only, Saumya means a human form. That human form with the two hands and seeing you. Now I have come back to my senses. Then again Sri Bhagavan Vacha. Again Krishna, from here to next 3-4 shlokas. Krishna is telling about 52, 53, 54 and 55. These four shlokas, they form a sort of introduction to the next chapter. So this chapter is going to end with 55, shloka number 55. So now we have to read this 52. So 52 to 55, these four shlokas, it is going to be a sort of introduction to the next chapter, which is talking about devotion, bhakti. So Krishna is just preparing the ground for that. In 52nd shloka, we see that Shri Bhagavanu Vacha Sudurdarshamidam Rupam Drushtavanasiyan Mama Devapyasya Rupasya Nityam Darshanakankshinaha. So he says, this particular form which we saw, it is something which is very, very difficult to see. Not only it is terrific, but also you should have done a lot of punyam. And you should have done a lot of shravanam, you must have done a lot of shravanam to see this particular form. But without all that, by my yoga shakti, I showed it to you. So durdarsham. Durdarsham means, darshanam means seeing. Durdarsham is something which is very, very difficult to be seen. So durdarsham, very, very difficult to be seen. So durdarsham, idam rupam, this particular form is very, very difficult. Whatever, yat dushtavanasi, mama rupam yat dushtavanasi. My rupam which you have seen. We will just take a break and resume. Let us resume. So whatever form which you have seen, it is very, very difficult to see. Deva pyasya rupasya. Even the gods, they long to see it. They aspire to see it. They are waiting to see that. Deva pi asya rupasya nisyam nityam darshana kankshinaha. Darshana kankshi. Kanksha is desire. Darshana kanksha is desire to see. Darshana kankshinaha means all those people, they are always desiring to see this particular form. After all, even in temples, in a normal form, we are so desirous to see. When there is some festival and when there is some sort of decoration to a particular god or goddess, people throng to see, oh, Lord Venkateshwara is so well decorated, or so-and-so goddess is so well decorated. So people just, they desire to see this form. And now Arjuna, this form which Arjuna saw was something which was unimaginable. Unimaginable in the sense that all the forms which are there in the world, they are all included in one place. That is it is a sort of universal form. Wherever namo namah purastat namah paschat, that is in front of me, he is in front of him, he saw him, to in his back he saw, to his right side he saw, to his left side he saw, all around he saw the same form. So that was the nature of that form. So deva api asya rupasya, even the gods, they want to see it. So Krishna is actually, he is now in the next shloka also, he is telling the same. That is 53rd shloka. This is also simple shloka, that is why I am going fast. Naham vedairna tapasa, shloka number 53. Naham vedairna tapasa, na danena na chejjaya, shakya evam vidho drashtum, drushtavanasi maam yatha. So naham vedaihi, like he said in the earlier shloka, just now we said in the earlier shloka, shloka number 48, yesterday we saw, na veda yajna dhyayanaihi, na danaihi, not by the study of Veda, not by performance of yajna. Almost the same thing he is saying, naham vedaihi, vedaihi, by the study of the Vedas, you cannot see this, na tapasa, not by doing any type of tapas, and na dhanena, not by doing all the philanthropic activities, na cha ijyaya is na cha ijya, ijya means yajna, ijya is yajna, by performing various yajnas, Vedas particularly describe so many types of yajnas for so many reasons. In order to achieve so many results, suppose a king wants that in his kingdom there has to be good rain. So there is one particular rishti called Kari Reshti. By performing that Kari Reshti, the king has to perform it, and there is plenty of rain in that land. And suppose the king wants something else. So he wants some victory over his enemy. He has to perform some other yajna. So like that, there are so many yajnas. Swarga kamo is a normal form. A normal yajna is for attaining swarga. So that is by all the people. So like that yajna. And naham vedairna tapasa najana dhanena nachejjaya. Not by all these. Krishna has given a list of all these things and he has negated all these things. Na shakya evam vidho drashtum. That shakya evam vidho drashtum, that na, in the beginning of this shloka, na vedaihi, na tapasa, na danena shakya, that is na applies to this shakya, na shakya, that is, it is not possible to see me, not possible to see me, evam vidho drashtum, not in this particular form, it is just not possible to be seen, drushtavanasi, yamam yatha, maam yatha drushtavanasi, means, you have whatever form which you have seen now, this particular form will not be seen by all the people who perform yajnas, all the people who study Vedas, all the people who do so many other austerities. This cannot be seen. And we come to the next shloka, which is a very, very important shloka. A very important shloka where Krishna is talking about the concept of bhakti. It's a very, very important shloka, shloka number 54. Bhaktya tvananyaya shakya aham evam vidhorjuna jnatum drashtum cha tatvena praveshtum cha parantapa. So he is, I will explain the words first. Bhaktya tu ananyaya, that is tu means on the other hand. So earlier he said, I cannot be seen by Vedas, I cannot be seen by Yajna, I cannot be seen by Dana, etc., etc. But bhaktya tu means but, or on the other hand. So that on the other hand means you have there is some way of seeing it. It is not as though, if you can't see that form also, why should we read Gita? That is the basic question. If he rules out all these things, okay, by performing yajnas you cannot see, by doing Veda you cannot see, by doing Dhanam you cannot see. If you say like that, then what is the use of reading Gita? That doubt may arise. So then that is the reason why Krishna is saying, but you can see me by that ananya bhakti. Bhaktya tvananyaya, bhaktya tu ananyaya. This ananya is the adjective for bhakti. Ananya bhakti. So this word also we have to understand. This word is very important here. Anya. Anya is what? Anya means other person. Ananya means not different. Anya means somebody who is different. Ananya means not somebody who is different. Ananya bhakti is what, like we say, ananya prema. First of all, let us understand prema. In fact, Swami Tattvavidananda gives one interesting example here. For example, let us take an ordinary example, bhakti example first, and then go to prema. Suppose you go to your temple. You go to your temple and then you worship God. And you pray to God that, okay, O Lord, you please give me this, give me that, give me that. Then, where is the prema? The prema, is it towards the God or towards the object which you are desiring? Suppose you want some contract. You want some big contract or some big benefit in business, or you want something good. So, then you are going and then you are worshipping, you are doing some bhakti. Bhakti means all semblance of bhakti is there. Then, is your bhakti towards the God or is it towards the object which you want? You want, suppose you go and then you say, okay, normally we have got what is called a sankalpa. When you go to a temple, there is a sankalpa. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha, chaturvidha, phala, purusharta, siddhyartham. Even that is okay because you are asking for dharma, artha, kama and moksha. These are the four human goals. To that extent, it is agreeable because you are at least including that moksha at the end. But not only this, it will go with Ayuhu, Arogya, Aishwarya, Siddhyartham. Oh, you want this health, you want Arogya, you want Aishwarya, you want Rajadware, Digvijaya Praptyartham. When you go to your boss, Rajadwara means nowadays we don't have kings. So you go to a boss, that is Rajadwara for all of us. And Digvijaya, and your boss has to pat on the back. You are always in the good books of your boss. Rajadware, Digvijaya Siddhyartham. And then the Purohitas, they invent such long sankalpas. In fact, I don't remember. If you go to a temple normally, the temple pujari will invent, he will have a long list. Putra Siddhyartham, Dauhitra Siddhyartham, whatever it is, whatever you want, he will say. So, all those things. So, that is you are interested in these things and not in God. So, that is what is called Anya Bhakti. And I was telling about Swami Tattvavidananda, who gives the example of prema also. Suppose there is a lover, there is a boy and a girl, and the boy is about to marry a girl. Suppose he says, okay, I love you. Okay, the girl also feels happy, yes, this gentleman is loving me. And suppose he says, yes, your father is such a rich man, he has got a very big bank account. So immediately the girl understands, yes, this fellow's love is not towards me, this fellow's love is towards the bank account. So she may even give a slap to this boy. So that is not prema, that is not ananya prema, that is anya prema. Anya prema means your love is not towards that lady, your love is towards that anya, that is towards the bank account. And when you go to the God and you want something, some big money, etc., your bhakti is anya bhakti, not ananya bhakti. Ananya bhakti is nishkama bhakti. That is, you are just loving God for the sake of God. You are just loving God because something which is lovable. It is not as though you are doing a favor to God. It is not as though when you are... This is another problem. When we want to say, even long ago, even I was also like that. When you want somebody, yes, you show some, this bhakti is something good, and then do some prayer every day. And bhakti, many people, they feel it very, they find it very, very difficult to come to the path of bhakti because, number one, their ego is ego comes in. How can I sit? I am such a great man. How can I sit? How can I have a small towel or dhoti and then sit in front of a God, surrendering myself? What is all this nonsense? So that is what is the picture. And slowly, when you read some books, when you have some understanding of what is the divinity, there is something which is guiding us. There is something which is that all-pervading, what we call this spirit or all-pervading consciousness. Something, some power is there which is directing us. Then, okay, he tries to sit and then he tries to think about that. So, slowly and slowly he comes to that. And maybe people also have that anya bhakti. Yes, if I go to Tirupati, all my desires will be fulfilled. Or if I go to somewhere else, my desires will be fulfilled. So, even educated people, highly educated people, they just do that. And then apart from that, they have no idea of what is called ananya bhakti. There is purely anya bhakti. Purely, yes, last time I went to this place, or I went to this Baba and my work was done. So, I am a devotee of this Baba. And tomorrow somebody else will say, no, this is another Baba is greater. So this man will go to another Baba and then he says, yes, my job was done. So this Baba is great. So your bhakti is to your objective and not that ananya bhakti to anything. So ananya bhakti is what is called nishkama bhakti. Ananya bhakti is what is called nishkama bhakti. And nishkama bhakti is something where in which you are not seeking anything. You are loving God for the sake of it, because you are overwhelmed. You are like Arjuna is overwhelmed to see that grand universal form. You are overwhelmed by the greatness of the Lord, and then you are trying to, in the first stage, you are trying to worship it. Then slowly and slowly you realize that you are not different from that. So, ananya bhakti, for this word ananya bhakti, the commentators have given two types of meanings. Ananya bhakti, commentators in fact, they have given two levels of meaning. The first level is, you are worshipping God for the sake of God. And you are worshipping that universal form. And you are not thinking of any other smaller form. You are not thinking of this small form for so-and-so purpose, some other small form for so-and-so purpose. You are thinking of that great form, that universal form, and nothing else. You want to know that, you want to follow that absolute form and nothing else. So that is ananya bhakti. And the second level is, that is a different state, a higher state. In fact, Shankaracharya says, Vasu sarvaihi api karanaihi vasudevad anyatna upalabhya anyatna upalabhyate. I will explain those Sanskrit words in English. That is, he has attained a particular state of enlightenment in which he sees everything as not different from that Brahman. That is what we call Brahman consciousness, Brahman awareness. So in fact, we got this word even earlier, Brahman consciousness. I used this word even earlier. That is a state of mind, a state of enlightenment in which you are seeing Brahman everywhere. So that is ananya bhakti. So for this ananya bhakti, we are using two meaning. We are having two levels of meaning. That one meaning is, you are following God for the sake of God, that nishkama bhakti. And even that God, you are not thinking about this God, that God, Venkateshwara, and Ishwara. You don't see two differences. You don't see difference among Venkateshwara and Ishwara. Ishwara in Tirupati, so what is this? Kashi, suppose you go to Kashi. Kashi Vishwanath is different and then Venkateshwara is different. So and so Rama is different and Krishna is different. Krishna is different from somebody else or somebody, this some other Amavaru. So all these things, he does not see the difference. He sees only one thing. And in that one thing, he has the devotion. And he uses that as a sort of tool for meditation. That is the primary level. And the second level, he attains that realization. Once he attains that realization, then he sees Brahman everywhere, including himself. When he sees Brahman everywhere, he sees that Brahman as himself. So that is that higher level. That is the meaning of this ananya bhakti. Slowly and slowly, one has to come to that level. That is what Krishna is suggesting. That is what Krishna is going to show in the 12th chapter. So we will continue this shloka tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.